a few minutes this morning on the subject, unwavering faith. By faith. Look at your neighbor and say, by faith. So today I struggle sometimes in Northwoods because you guys kind of get comfortable real easy, and I'm going to have to start, we're going to have to sell these pews and put razor blades out there sometimes just because y'all get too comfortable, I'm a holler back preacher, so if I say something and talks with you and you holler back, I tend to preach a little quicker and get out faster. But folks like, no, Pastor John's preaching about 2 hours. If you holler back, y'all get done quicker, I promise you. Amen. In closing, I want to say, I'm going to need your help today. And as I preach this sermon, and this might be a little youth oriented. So y'all been yelling all weekend. What's just a couple more times before you go home and sleep the rest of the week? You're out of school for the summer. You got plenty of time to sleep right before you get up at 6 in the morning to cut the grass. So when I get to a place and you see me hold the mic, I want you to say, by faith. Look at your neighbor. Practice on your neighbor's eardrum. Just say it one time. By faith. There you go. A couple of them didn't look like that hurt. Try it again. By faith.
By faith.
All right, now let's try to see how y'all going to be able to get the key.
By faith.
All right. So if I'm in the middle of preaching and I get to the point and you're getting ready to run and you see the mic go,
by faith.
Then you run. But make sure you do
by faith
first, so we'll get it all right? Because by faith, things happen. He said, we got to dig the well of faith. So I'm going to hold this little shovel. I told my wife, I said, I'm holding on to my shovel. Because I believe that this is my answer to my prayer. I didn't call Jensen. You know, I taught him a lot of things as he was growing up. But he didn't call me and tell me what he was preaching. And I didn't teach Jensen directly anything, I promise you. But he's taught me some stuff. Anyhow, I didn't know what he was preaching. He done something. He began to dig in the well. But before I go any further, I can't let this Sunday go without sharing to you one of the most funniest yet awesome biblical points he brought about. And my wife got up here and she stressed about worship, about how important it is that we worship. He was talking about digging the wells, how Abraham dug the wells. Abraham was a man of faith. We're going to hear about him just a hair this morning. But when he had his son Isaac, who he did pray for by faith, received his son by faith, then was asked to give up his son, and it required faith. So they go to a certain point, and he looks up into a mountain. And he says, all right, he tells his little helpers, he said, y'all and the donkeys stay here. We're going yonder. You do-nuts and these do-nothing donkeys stay here. Me and the lads going yonder to the mountain of God. In the King James Version, Bruce said, what's it say in the King James Version? He don't say donkeys in the King James Version. This is Jensen Franklin preaching. And it's King James Version. It don't say donkeys in the King James Version. He calls them asses.
That's right.
And I love what Jensen said. He said, if we really going to dig some wells, you need to know what you look like when worship's going on and you're just standing around here. He said, you like one of them do-nothing donkeys. He said, you look like what the King James Version called an ass. When you won't worship, the well's not being dug. And the only way to dig the well is you got to be willing. In order to get to the water, you got to be willing to get to the hole. Get in the hole. You got to pass through the pit to get to the water. You can dig and dig and dig and dig and dig. But when you break ground and you get to that water, it's worth the dig. I promise you. As my wife said, I loved it. I shouted. I jumped. I almost ran. But I wanted to share that with you jokingly. But at the same time, worship's not something we do when it feels good.
Amen.
Worship is a lifestyle.
Right.
Worship is something we do. And we do it because we know what God's done for us. And we know what God does for us
by faith.
Amen. So if you have your Bibles this morning, we're going to read the book of Hebrews. Y'all waiting for a chapter and a verse? We're going to read the book of Hebrews this morning. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith. Somebody say, now faith.
Now faith.
Not yesterday faith.
Now
today's faith.
Not
tomorrow's faith.
Not
in the morning's faith. Definitely
not grandma's faith.
Not the pastor's faith. But now faith. Is the substance, read it with me, is the substance of things and the of things not seen. Look at your neighbor and say,
you read well.
Awesome. Father God, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you that it is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. I pray, God, over the next few minutes, you will put it inside of my belly. Lord, bring to remembrance the things you've put in my belly. Lord, bring that passion and fire, that zeal, not for me to be seen, but that you might be seen through me. Let me decrease that you may increase, God. And I pray that if any man look upon me, that they not see me, because I am a wretched sinner. But God, you saved my soul, and the spirit that lives in me is the same spirit that raised you from the dead. So I pray today, God, that they will see the works that I might work and glorify my Father, which is in heaven. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody says,
amen,
amen, amen, amen. So, unwavering faith. Unwavering faith. Does anybody know what unwavering means?
Not movable.
Unmovable. Immovable. Unmovable. I've been messing up words all this weekend. I might as well not stop now.
We're from Georgia.
We from Georgia. We make words as we talk. Y'all ain't not never gonna.
That's right.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. It is the substance of things hoped for. Have you ever hoped for something in your life? Have you ever hoped for a better job? Have you ever hoped for a promotion, or hoped for a child, or hoped for a helpmate, or hoped for the bank to give you the loan, or the closing to be what you wanted to be so you could get that house or the property, or the church would be, you hope it would get to a certain place? Can I tell you, hope is only a sign that you got to put your faith in action. If you've got a hope, you can't just hope and sit on a rocking chair, flip through the channels, and hope somebody on the news is going to give you the answers to all the world's problems. You can't hope from a worldly point of view. You can't get around worldly folks and think that your hope is enough to see God come to pass in your life. Because God's already done what he needs to do.
Amen.
He's already done what he said he would do. We've been shouting all weekend. Can't hang with the youngins anymore.
I thought we were on fleek.
We're on fleek. I learned that when you paint your eyebrows blue, your eyebrows on fleek. But when folks are jealous of your eyebrows on fleek, they throw shade on you. Faith, the substance of things hoped for. What is the church supposed to do today? When we look out across the world and we see things, like Pastor Jensen touched on, he said there's some things that we got to change in our modern day thinking. And I'm not talking about the millennials. I'm talking about the generation that dug the well. And that is, don't curse the generation that hasn't dug it up again yet. But have faith that God is going to use that. As he said, I still believe that we are, that this younger generation is the greatest generation to ever live on the face of this planet, because everything they have, they don't have to go through years and years and years of college. Anything they want to know is at the touch of their finger. Anything that they want to have, they can Google it, they can search it. Any place they want to go, they can type it in and get there without my help, without mama's help. If they want to know what the best interest rate is, they don't have to call daddy and say, what do you think? They can Google it. They can find it on the internet. But the other issue with that is they get too caught up in trying to find the answers in the world, and they try to find the answers in their technology, and Holy Spirit continues to get plugged. The well of goodness, the well of power, the well of grace, the well of mercy gets spilled in while we're touching the screen to find out. Hey, Reggie Dabbs did an awesome title last night. He said, the title of his sermon was, turn your phone off and look me in the eye.
That's right.
Turn your phone off and look me in the eye. Because faith is going to take more than just head knowledge. Faith is going to take more than just that moment in the service when the chill bumps start moving and everything feels good. Faith is going to be something that gets great. If you want to see the church get to the level that it's called to do, you're going to have to do it
by faith,
because when faith is put into action, then everything that was hoped for becomes physical. It becomes real. Oh, I hope we get somebody baptized in the Holy Ghost. I hope somebody gets up and walks out of a wheelchair. I hope blinded eyes are opened in today's service. My question is if a blind person walks in and sits down beside you, do you have enough faith to lay your hands on their eyes and believe that they can open them and see again? Because faith is the substance of the things you've been hoping for. How many years have we prayed for healing, revivals, and signs and wonders to fill the church? But the moment a brokenness walks in the door, we try to give them a pep talk and an encouraging word and make them feel good. And we don't want them to feel rejected, and we don't want them to feel like they could possibly go to hell for the choices that they've made. But in reality, we've got to pray and have faith for the things that we've hoped for. And the only way we get substance out of our hope is
by faith.
Let's go to the second cause of this scripture. It is the evidence of things not seen. Substance of things hoped for, and the elders, I'm reading the scripture on the board, and the evidence of things not seen. Why do we live in a culture that has struggled so hard believing that the same Holy Ghost that fell in Acts chapter 2 is still the same Holy Ghost today? Why do we live in such a modern day? I'm not talking about, I expect the secular world not to have the faith. But we live in a church generation that lacks faith, that lacks signs and wonders. We wonder why people don't believe. But the Bible says, signs, they shall see signs and wonders and believe. But if I come and I tell you that there's been a murder and Ashley is guilty. If it's me that's gone, search into it.
You better act right.
But if I tell you, what's the first thing they're going to try to do? Are they just going to assume that whoever said she was guilty just doesn't tell lies? And they're going to search for something. You know what that's called?
Evidence.
So if I come and I tell you, in the middle of your broken situation, or you come to a revival, or you come to church on Sunday morning, you hear Pastor Josh say, Jesus Christ loves those who are brokenhearted, and he cares for those with a contrite spirit, and he heals those, and he saves those, and he reaches out into the storm, he reaches out into the problem situations, and he saves those. And then when you open your Bible, your day just keeps getting worse. And you go home and your day just keeps falling apart. And you go to work and you lose your job, or you lose your mind, or you lose your child, or whatever the case may be. And all these things get going on. Evidence is lacking. So guess what else begins to waver? Faith. When evidence starts lacking, faith begins to waver. Now, it isn't my job to make you faithful.
Come on.
I can stand up here and I can marry you and your spouse, and I can pronounce all the good words and all the good scriptures, and I can say what God has put together, let no man tear asunder. But when you leave this room, it's up to you to remain faithful to the one that you have married.
Amen.
But I can tell you that without faithfulness, one won't be one. Without faith, the substance won't be there. Without faith, evidence of a pure marriage won't exist. Faith in a church that doesn't have evidence will only be a talk and not a walk. In other words, what I have to ask myself as an individual, not as a pastor, I'm talking about when I go into any building where there's a minister, that's going to be preaching to me. Before I ever walk through those doors, this is something Josh Toomey has to do. I have to clean my mind and say, Lord, I'm not just going in here thinking that they're going to preach everything that I like. I've got to clear my mind and say, Lord, we just got to get back to the days of faithfulness like David had when he said, Lord, if there be any unclean thing in me, Lord, search me. And if there be any unclean thing in me, Lord, let me know. Don't let me walk around thinking that what is right is wrong and what is wrong is right and make me believe a lie. Because the Bible says, and if you keep on, you keep on, he will turn you over to a reprobate mind and you will believe a lie. Anytime you lack faith, you are on the highway to a reprobate mind where you believe a lie. He said he will sear your mind with a hot iron and make you believe a lie.
Amen.
What does that mean? If evidence is lacking, people aren't just going to hear talking. They want to see signs and wonders. One, and it ain't about worshiping the signs and wonders, but I'm going to go and tell you. Before somebody comes up to me because they read something in a theology book or a health book, or they went and studied Latin and found some word that if you mix this word with this word and this language and this word over here, that it means this. Before I change everything I believe, you're going to have to show me some evidence, because what I believe right now, I believe. And if you can't show me something that's going to touch my faith and not my mind, because listen, the Bible says that so as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. We got a bunch of folks, the reason they're tossed to and fro is because they think with this thing upstairs, and it messes everybody up, because this thing upstairs is rooted in your flesh. And then when you start trying to listen to how it thinks, you end up going the wrong direction. But the Bible says, as a man thinketh not in his mind, but in his heart, so is he. If you want to be faithful, you've got to get past all the things that you want to hear, that you want to feel, and say, Lord, show me the evidence. Lord, show me your glory. Lord, show me your mercy. Show me your unadulterated love. Show me the pureness that comes by knowing you as my Savior.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 11, the scholars call it the Hall of Faith. Hall of Faith. We pay money to go walk through and see pictures of people that have made great accomplishment over sports decades in history. But none of them compare to the Hall of Faith. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. The writer of Hebrews says, and the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good testimony. By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of the things which are visible. So, we understand. If you want to truly come to understanding the word of God, it's going to take more than your knowledge. It's going to take more than your ability to dress for church. It's going to take more than your ability to just speak in languages. It's going to take more. It's going to take faith to be able to understand that God, that the worlds were framed and made by the word of God.
Amen.
Also, next scripture.
By
faith. Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gift, and through it he being dead still speaks. We know the story of Cain and Abel. When Cain killed Abel, the Bible says God come up and asked him where he said he hears his blood crying from the ground. The thing that happens is people look at the mindset that my faith might cost me my life. And brother, Pastor Ryan spoke on it last week about Jezebel. Jezebel went to Elijah after something in Elijah nobody else had went after. His spear. Jezebel pricked his spear, made him afraid. But you want me to tell you, fear is the enemy of your faith. Fear and faith are not friends. They don't talk to each other. They don't hang out at the club. They don't go play ball together. They don't walk down the street together. They don't ride in the car together. They don't work on the same block. They don't even live in the same neighborhood. They won't allow each other to stay around each other because they hate each other. Fear hates faith, and faith hates fear.
That's right.
But fear, let me tell you what fear is. You can can write this down, put it on your head, whatever you want to do, make a hat, put it on a t-shirt. Fear is a lie that the enemy tells your faith. When your faith says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and somebody hands you a microphone.
Come on.
Fear says, I can't. When the word of God says that he can do exceeding abundantly above all that is able, all that you ask or think of, amen. The Bible says that, and then fear says, it stays forward, there's no hope. When faith says, I can stick this staff out over the sea and it's going to open up for me and I'm going to move across the Red Sea and I'm going to bury everything that's chasing me behind me, never to be seen again. Your fear tells you you're trapped. You're in a corner. What are you going to do? You might as well turn yourself back into the enemy. You'll be safer if you just go back to Egypt. Oh, if you just go back to where you came from, it'll be nicer. Let me tell you, God is telling some people in this modern day generation, oh, if you just go back to the way things used to be. Listen, I love the good old days too, but God ain't looking for a good old day church. He's looking for some people that will get out there and dig the wells of faith, amen. Come just getting around and hooping and shouting and hollering ain't gonna be enough. God's looking for some people that will come up out of the grave and raise the dead folks with it. God's looking for some spirit-filled, baptized believers that will get up in the middle of church when hell's coming in and offenses are starting around. And somebody will get up and say, and then they're catching them. It isn't by our power. It isn't by our strength. Oh, God, brother, I've been praying for the gifts of the Spirit. I've been praying God would use me, and it hadn't happened yet. My question is, have you had faith that when you open your mouth to do the things you want to do, whether it's healing, whether it's prophecy, whether it's tongues, whether it's any of these things, have you done it in faith, believing? Amen. If you will have faith, then believe. Faith. Next scripture. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death and was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. He did it
by faith.
But listen to this. The writer of Hebrews, he's telling you by faith, Abraham done it. By faith, Abel done it. By faith, Enoch done it. But then he says, hold on before you get too caught up in by saying,
by faith.
Then he says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Well, brother, I thought I had faith when I prayed. I thought I had faith. The Bible says he didn't say he's going to try to reward you. He didn't say he might reward you. He didn't say he's going to get to you. Then later when he pulls your ticket, he didn't say he's going to help you. He didn't say he's gonna, he said he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. You want me to tell you something else faith does? You can write this down. Faith gives you the endurance to seek God the way he must be sought, that he may be found while he is near. Faith gives you endurance to seek God the way he needs to be sought. By faith. Somebody say it.
By faith.
Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. By faith, you will come to know the things that are still to come before they ever arrive. But you ought to have it
by faith.
By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going, but he found his way anyway. He left his city. He left his home. He left his own country to go into a city, or to go into a country that was maker and builder was God. He was going, what he didn't know was God wasn't taking him to just dwell in Thomasville. God wasn't looking to give him an address. God wasn't looking for him to have a P.O. box. But God was showing Abraham, and Abraham didn't even know it, but we know it now because we know the story. Is God wasn't just telling Abraham, I'm going to do some good things with you. Abraham had to have faith and believe. We're going to get to that here in just a moment. But Abraham walked out there, and he was still looking for a country. It must be out here somewhere. I'm going to keep walking this way. Oh, God, I feel God telling me to turn this way. I'm going to walk this way. Oh, I feel God saying go this way. What Abraham did not know is God wasn't taking him to a peculiar geographical location on the map. What Abraham was doing was everywhere that the sole of his feet would tread, God was saying, that have I given unto you. I'm not telling you that you're on your way just to Thomasville. I'm telling you I'm sending you to the nations to go and baptize them, teach them my commandments, and fill them with the Holy Ghost that the church may grow and explode in faith, because we need it more than we've ever needed it before. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. Imagine being like Abraham, walking around with your children from tent to tent, from dirt road to dirt road, from backwoods to backwoods, from swamp to swamp, and everywhere you go, you're carrying a child with you, and you're wondering, Lord, I'm still looking for something I ain't found. Lord, I got a promised child with me. I'm walking around with them, and I'm keeping them, and I got them in tents, and it's hard for me to look at these two and really think that they're going to be numbered like the stars in the heavens and the sand on the sea. But Lord, I'm going to walk anyway. You got to get to the place the devil's going to try to speak to you. He's not going to. See, what happens is God looks at your future and plans your today. The devil looks at your today and tries to scare you of your future. So what happens is when the Lord says, I'm going to number your seed like the sea of the star, like the stars in the sky, the sand on the sea, then the enemy comes right behind him and says, yeah, but look at what you've got. Can it really happen here? It's like I told these youth when we went up there and 13,000 people sitting in an arena worshiping and just praising the Lord, and people standing up there worshiping and praising, and yes, there's lights, yes, there's loud music, yes, there's screens, yes, there's games going on, but you know what? There's also, we can talk about all the stuff that we want to complain and bicker about and everything in the secular world, but there's also souls being saved. There's also preachers coming up. There's also people getting scholarships to go to college. There's also people putting money so that sex trafficking can be beat. There was young people taking their little bit of money, $25 mama gave them, to go down there and spend for a whole weekend, and they would take their money out of their wallet. Our own kids were doing this. They were putting up stuff that they wanted to buy. They were putting it up so that they could put offering in the plate because they wanted sex trafficking to cease in America, and they wanted to help the ministry. You know why they did that? Because somebody told these young people that if you have faith and believe, God will take your two fish and five loaves, and he will multiply it, and you might only put a dollar, but God will take your dollar all the way to California somewhere and release a woman that's been trapped in this. We get so caught up on the little things that we don't even care about faith anymore. We just want folks to look like we used to look when I preached back then. Or we want folks to sing like we sang. Or we want folks to drive what we drove. Or we want people to treat their kids the way we taught our kids. Listen to me. I'm a firm believer. The Bible says you can beat them. They won't die. Beat them. Beat them. Beat them. Bible says it. Go look at it. It says you'll beat them and they won't die. Bible, why all y'all youth looking at me like, y'all, you just move on, Pastor. Beat them and they won't die. But you spare the rod and you hate the child. You keep looking at them saying, oh, I just don't want them. Then we get a generation that say, I was born this way. I was just born like this. I was born with my ADD. I was born with my problems. I was born with my love, who I love. I can't hear. That's why the Bible says you must be born again. He didn't want you to live how you was born. He says you must be born again. The only way to inherit the kingdom of heaven is you must be born again, the Bible says. So it does not matter what you have, what happened in your kindergarten class. It don't matter what happened in the lunchroom. It don't matter what happened in daycare when little Johnny took your sucker and bit you on the arm. What matters is the fact that when you came to know Jesus Christ, you went to that altar and you said, Lord, I'm not entering again into my mother's womb, but I'm standing here at the floodgates of heaven, and I've got faith that if I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, these gates are about to open, and I'm about to receive a flood of mercy and grace and power and authority. And when I leave this place, victory. I'm walking out in authority, and I'm walking out in power. Somebody give God a shout of praise. Real quick, we're running low on time. My business is just read this out for you. We're going to close. If I can go ahead and get my musicians coming. Somebody looks at your neighbor and say, wow, he ain't never preached this fast. Hey. Somebody came to church with faith this morning. They were going to get out by noon, by 12:30. And it worked. Hallelujah. Hebrews 11:10, talking about he went with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him, on the same promise. And verse 10 says, for he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Let me tell you something. We got some good construction folks in this house. But there ain't a person in here got the skill to build what God built for me. And I tell you, there ain't nothing worth preaching better than preaching about the kingdom of God. Because the Bible says his kingdom come, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. His kingdom is able to move with faith. Amen. God don't got to move, but his kingdom will. Amen. When his people, we are his kingdom. And when we step out and say, I've had enough of us sitting here beating around the bush about what's right and what's wrong. I've had enough of what's wrong. Who's going to go to hell? Who ain't going to go to hell? I'm not here to send anybody to hell. I'm here to tell you Jesus Christ is the way to the Father. And if you will believe on him, I don't care what you are wrong about. You made right in the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Verse 11 says, by faith Sarah herself also received strength to conceive the seed. Somebody say,
by faith.
You're able to receive strength. And she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky. And what I love how that says that. One man, him as good as dead. God said he used him by faith to number the children as the stars in the sky. They were innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. But listen to this. Listen to these faith people. These people that I just mentioned, the writer of Hebrews is saying, these people I just told you about, listen what happens to them. They all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on earth. Let me put that in South Georgia Church of God terms. He said these folks went to church faithfully and they prayed. They was bringing their children's doctors to church. Amen. While they were still in the hospital praying over their children to be ministers of the gospel, saved, baptized, full of the Holy Ghost. He said these people had faith and they came and they died having not yet seen the promise fulfilled. In other words, they died before that youngin' become a preacher. They died before that person got the job. They died before that blessing hit their family. They died before they seen it. But the good news is that they didn't die wondering if God's able to do it. They died having seen the promises way up there. And they knew it don't matter. I'm not here to get it for me. I'm not here to get my fix. We got to get back to the place, like Sister Ashley said, which Jensen said in his message, that we quit thinking we're here to dig a well for me and mine. The Bible says that when they would dig a well, it was for not just their children, but their grandchildren.
Amen.
We got to start today digging a well that my grandkids can dig in. And there's some things you can't compromise. There's some things you can't give up. Yeah, you can change the rhythm of the music. Yeah, you can put the lights or you can turn them off. You can turn them on. You can put the words in a book or you can put them on the screen. There's a whole lot of things you can compromise and still be all right with God. But you can't compromise, amen, sanctification. You can't compromise baptism. You can't compromise, amen, coming to confession and knowing Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. There's some things you can't compromise, like modesty. There's some things you can't compromise, like holy matrimony. There's some things you can't compromise, amen, like one mate, amen. There's some things you can't compromise. I didn't get to hear it yesterday because I knew I had to drive home. But yesterday morning, they said a guy preached a sermon. Him and his wife were called to preach to young people about sex. And they said he preached an entire sermon about pineapples.
Yeah.
Pineapples and pineapple chunks. But what the key point to it was, Chris McComas them sailed over. See, I got my connections. The youth court don't know how. I just got my inside man that fills me in on these things. And my inside man told me that when Christopher Columbus sailed over to America, that over there, way back home, these guys didn't know what pineapples were. They'd never seen one. But when he started, when pineapples started going back home, folks were like, wow, these things are good. These things are awesome. All the way to the point that people was renting pineapples. One pineapple sold for like $8,000, equivalent to $8,000 here.
Only the rich people
had. See, my inside man told me this, but they just put it in as 2 cents now. My inside man, that guy, I'm just kidding. Only the rich folks had them. You know why, though? You know what that tells you? They were valuable.
That's right.
Everybody didn't have one. But then he broke it down and he talks about how pineapples got more popular and got out a little easier, kind of got around a little better. And now today you can just walk into a grocery store and you can go buy a can of chunks where somebody didn't have their hands all over and they didn't cut it up. He was telling our young people, don't settle for chunk pineapple. Don't settle for things that had hands all over. Don't be a chunky pineapple. Don't be a valuable pineapple. Be one that's peeled off the branch that nobody else has had before. But it's hard to stay pure in today's society without faith. You've got to have faith to remain. Because I'm telling you, there's a whole lot that I cannot play sports. I like to hear your sports stories. I like to hear your fishing stories. You hear mine. We'll talk about stuff. We'll share those kinds of things. But that woman walking out that door because she's tired of hearing me preach. Hey, amen. I ain't sharing her with nobody. Because she's my pineapple. She's my pineapple. By faith, they all died, but they saw the promises ahead. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. But now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Verse 17. Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said, in Isaac. This has got all kind of depth in it. And of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. I ain't got time to preach on this, but you know Isaac was his promised son. Isaac was the promise that his seed was going to multiply through. And right before he saw the multiplication of his seed, God said, now give him back. And by faith, he was willing to do it. Concluding that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from which he also received him in figurative sense. He already knew he had faith God would raise him up. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph and worshiped, leaning on the top of his staff. By faith, Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departure of the children of Israel and gave instructions concerning his bones. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's command. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he looked to the reward. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he who destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith, they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, whereas the Egyptians, attempting to do so, were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe when she had received the spies with peace. A few more scriptures. And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel the prophet. He said, I ain't got enough time to keep telling you all the faith stories. These guys thought through faith subdued kingdoms. They worked righteousness. They obtained promises and they stopped the mouths of lions. They quenched the violence of fire. They escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weakness they were made strong. They became valiant in battle. Turned to the flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance that they might obtain a better resurrection. I'm going to say that one again. Women received their dead raised to life again. Listen to me. You don't let nobody else in this world curse your children to hell. You stand up and you raise your child to life again. Stand up for your child's faith. They ain't got to be saved for you to see the promise of. Start declaring it. Start pumping. Listen, don't settle for it. Don't say it's all right, but you pray for it and you start seeing your child walking in the salvation of the Lord and in the grace and the power of the one true King. Because let me tell you something. Women saw their dead raised to life again. By faith, women saw their dead raised to life again. Husbands started coming back to church. Husbands started lifting their hands and praising God. Husbands started getting on their knees at bedsides and leading people in prayer. Husbands started going around saying, God's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Husbands, amen, started coming and fighting the good fight, putting on the armor of God, walking in the sword. With the sword. Stand all over the house if you will. Others had trial of mockings and scourging, yes. In other words, people still had to, even with faith, had to go through scourging trials and fiery furnaces, chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sewn in two. Somebody would literally take a body and cut it in half. Because let me tell you something about your faith. Your faith makes hell nervous and anxious. And every time you have faith, hell wants to cut you in half. He wants to divide you. When hell starts seeing the church have faith, he comes to saw it in two. But I come to tell the devil not to nail, for I fight my battles. I rush into the Lord. I rush into the throne room. I gather the horns of the altar and I'm declaring to the Lord and I'm declaring over the church that we are a body of Christ. They were sown into two and they were tempted. They were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute and afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and dens and in caves of the earth. And all these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. God, having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. Can I tell you about a day that's coming in our very near future? A day that if you're not ready for it, I want to help you get ready for today if you'll let me. A day that these men we just spoke about knew was coming, but they died before it got here. The Bible says some had grown to sleep. In other words, they died in their faith. There are some every single day of our life, they're going into sleep, death. But can I tell you right now that day when all the family wears black and you get around the funeral of the church and you preach over a casket, or you're not preaching over a person. If that's a child of God, you're preaching over an old vessel, an empty vessel that was once used for God's glory. But that vessel is useless now. But the good news is that ain't the end. That ain't the end of the story. That ain't the end of that person you're talking about. That ain't the last time, amen, that there'll ever be a purpose for the kingdom. But the Bible says that when that trumpet sounds, that the dead in Christ are going to rise first. And they that are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet them in the air. And amen, we're going to have a reunion in the devil's territory. The devil is the prince of the air. We're going to meet our loved ones, our faith warriors in heaven, in the air, right where the devil's territory is. Now, you know what we're going to do on that day? We're going to help all of heaven let hell know how much it failed miserably. I got about three people that understood that. We're going to let all of hell know. You can't take my kids, but I want them to go into heaven. You can't take my family, but we're heading together. You can't just steal my church, but we're heading up together. You can't just kill my body, but cancer couldn't do it, so you hit me with stress. Stress couldn't do it, so you tried to make me depressed. Depressed didn't kill me. Why? Because every time you put your hand on me, God put his foot on you. And I got back up by faith, believing that I'm able. This morning, are you willing to dig those things inside of you that maybe the enemy's come to clog up? The devil don't need you to quit church. The devil don't need you to quit dancing and when the song's singing. All the devil needs you to do is quit being faithful. Because if you lose faith, you'll lose evidence. If you lose evidence, you'll lose substance. And if you lose substance, there's nothing to believe in. But I'm here to tell you today that I believe with everything in me, the church is about to see an awakening. We just went through a series of an awakening. The church is about, I'm not talking about Northwood, I'm talking about the body of Christ. We are about to see an awakening. And in this awakening, folks are going to know God's real. God, we ain't going to need programs, we ain't going to need friends, we ain't going to need trips, we ain't going to need Facebook to get them in the house. You're going to see people flooding the house. They got blinded eyes and deaf ears, and they're walking in it all with a crippled step. You're going to see people that's been struggling their whole life to put a pipe down, and they're going to walk in it in one trip. They're going to leave it here for good. You're going to see people lay down tobacco problems on these altars, and they're going to walk away, never to touch them again. You're going to see people walk.